In this build-along series, we'll take the genuine Prusa i3 Mark II and clone it. Follow along as we take a bunch of ridiculously cheap parts and try to make them work together. Today we're going to cover the mechanics, the frame, the linear guides, and the motion system. There are a few choices that you can make here to make things easier, but I think making as much as possible yourself is the way to go if you want to stay true to the core ideas of this build. I mean, this is the fun part after all, right? So let's start with the frame itself. As you can see, I already made a near perfect copy of the original one. It even has the Prusa name up top here, so you know it's the real deal. This one is cut from 18mm or 3/4 inch OSB board. It's not the greatest material ever, but it's certainly stronger and stiffer than MDF, particle board, or even thinner acrylic. To cut it out, I started with the original frame design files, overlaid an Escher grid as an alignment pattern, and then printed it with the poster function in Adobe Acrobat. I think the regular Adobe Reader has that functionality as well. The frame really isn't that large, so you're only going to use 4 A4 or letter-sized sheets of paper. I aligned them, stuck them together with tape, and then glued them onto the sheet. Glue stick works much better for this than wood glue, by the way. Then I started by drilling the holes in the frame. These do need to be fairly accurate, so take your time here. And I also drilled these seats for the threaded rod frame with a 10mm bit to get them perfectly round. The rest was just a bit of cutting everything out with the circular saw and jigsaw. The geometry of the frame isn't super crucial, so don't worry if your frame comes out looking as shoddy as mine. You can use whatever tools you have for this, whether it's a jigsaw, bandsaw, scroll saw, or even a fret saw. For the jigsaw, I can definitely recommend these thinner curved blades for the smaller details of the frame. It just makes getting in and out of the corners so much easier. To get the rest of the templates off, I gave it a quick pass with the belt sander and then went back and cleaned up the details with a file and rounded over the edges with some sandpaper. Now, you could make the bed frame from the same material, but I went with a 10mm, aka 3/8 of an inch MDF sheet here, since the bed subframe needs to be a bit lighter and the finer details don't lend themselves to the core structure of the OSB board anyways. So with a fresh printout of the template, again, you want to start out with the holes. You don't have to be as precise as with the mainframe here. But let's look at the way the bearings are mounted in here. The two outer holes are only through holes for zip ties, and the elongated cutout in the center is actually what aligns the bearings. These frames are made to be CNC cut, which would of course align the bearings perfectly, but when making these by hand, I'd actually recommend starting with a 10mm drill bit in the ends of the slots and then cutting the hole slightly tapered so that it's slimmer in the center, which will allow the bearing to self-align to the direction of the smooth rod. Otherwise, they might end up binding if they are just a tiny bit off. Remember, you can always come back with a file and adjust the shape to get them perfectly lined up. I also started with a 10mm drill bit in the corners of these larger cutouts and then cut between the holes to give them a rounded shape in the corners, which should make the part a bit harder to break. And again, these don't need to be Matthias Wandel level parts. How the edges look doesn't impact how the machine will perform in the slightest bit, but of course you can tidy them up and make everything look as neat as you want. So the holes here are sized to have M3 screws directly screwed into them without being tapped or anything. A 2.7mm drill bit works well here for me with OSB, but the screw lengths I've got in the bill of materials are long enough to stick out the back and be fastened with a washer and a nut there. Plus, if you mess up the hole, you can always just make it a bit bigger to align things properly. Of course, you could also just buy a full frame kit, but those cost around 40 bucks, while the materials used to make one myself were about 4 bucks if you'd actually buy them. In my case, it was literally scraps I had sitting around. Alternatively, you could route the frame out on a CNC router as well. The DXF files for that are on Prusa's GitHub pages. Talking of fasteners, again, the full list of parts I'm going to use is on toms3d.org/dolly, but the ones worth talking about are the following. Threaded rods. There are three sizes here, M5, M8, and M10. The M5 will be used for the Z-axis, so that one is sort of non-replaceable. But if metric threaded rods are hard to get for you or expensive in your country, you can substitute 5/16 and 3/8 of an inch threaded rod for the M8 and M10 ones. 1 meter of each is plenty, but I did order a second M5 rod just to have a backup if one of them should come bent. Plus, they are super cheap here anyways. Blank steel ones might be even cheaper than galvanized ones, but they will rust. Stainless is harder to cut and more expensive. Also, if you have the option of different strength grades, pick the cheapest one. We're not going to get anywhere close to their yield strength with the MK2 build. I've also tried to eliminate as many different variants of these screws as possible. While having 7 different sizes of M3 cap head screws won't matter much when you're buying tens of thousands of each size, us little people usually only buy a handful. And the interesting thing is, the smaller the lots you buy are, the more cost for just packaging stuff is going to factor in. For example, 2,000 stainless M3 washers don't even cost twice as much as just 200. But if you are interested in making things, which I would assume since right now you are watching a video about making a 3D printer from scratch, getting those bigger packs will leave you plenty of spares for projects down the road. I paid about 50 bucks for a full set of fasteners, screws, nuts, washers, and threaded rods, but it's enough for at least 5 printers, so I guess the effective value of all the hardware we need is about 10 bucks or so. If you have a decent hardware store nearby, and I'm not talking about the Home Depot or similar, you might just be able to buy the exact amount of fasteners you need. A few notes on the parts in here. Lock nuts. These have a small nylon section on the end that keeps them from coming loose, but they are expensive, so alternatively you can instead use 2 nuts and jam them against each other. Those are never going to come loose, or just use a regular nut with liquid thread lock or even super glue if you have to. Then I ordered all the M3 and M10 washers that will seat against the wooden frame as larger fender washers. These are about twice as large as regular ones. And lastly, the original Mark II uses some M5 hardware, but only in the extruder to hold the bearing. We do need a pair of M5 nuts for the Z-axis, but I've redesigned the extruder idler right here to not need any 5mm hardware at all. The bearing pin is printed and the side guides for the bearing are integrated into the idler, itself. Speaking of modified parts, I've also been working on making the printed parts fit the cheaper components used in this build, particularly the X and Y motor mounts to fit the larger end stops, the Y corners to fit standard length smooth rods, and some new ZX's nut holders. Also, spacers for the Arduino Mega Plus RAMs that will be the brains of this operation. The rest of the parts are the standard MK2 ones, and the ones I modified aren't that far off from the originals. If you already have a 3D printer, well, of course, print them, but alternatively, you could either have them printed at a local fab lab and learn a bit about the machines and the process, or try a service like 3D Hubs. The original Mark II uses ABS for everything but the electronics cover and power supply mount. Those parts are a copolyester. We'll still need to figure out a way to brace the power supply in here, but I've got a few ideas there. Realistically, I think most parts would be fine from PTG, CPE, copolyesters, whatever you want to call them, but I would print the extruder parts in X-axis carriage from ABS, HIPS, or ASA just to get that extra bit of temperature resistance. So far, I've printed all the parts from Rigid Ink ABS, and most parts actually don't care too much about print quality. So if they're printed coarsely or warped a bit, the final printer we build with them is still going to work just fine. Okay, what else? Well, linear motion, and that is guides and belts, essentially. The standard set of smooth rods for an i3 is 2 each of 320, 350, and 370mm 8mm rod. However, the MK2 uses 320, 330, and 370, which is really hard to buy. You could ask a seller to make them to size, or just go with a standard set and use 2 of the modified printed parts to have the rear of the Y-axis ones overhang. You might be able to find like stainless steel rods cheaper, but they are just going to wear in super quickly and leave you with an extremely sloppy axis in no time. Plus, at 27 bucks, you do get a set of rods you'll be able to use, even if you completely rebuild and upgrade this thing. For bearings, I found that there is little to no difference between the super cheap and slightly more expensive ones, so I'd recommend just getting the cheapest pack and picking up an extra pair so that you can choose the best ones. You need 10 pieces for the printer, so a dozen LM8U are less than 6 bucks. What you also need are belts and belt accessories. Since the printer uses open loop belts that get clamped at the ends, you can just buy a 2-meter length of belt as a set with 16 tooth pulleys for X and Y. Cut the belt to length as needed and spend less than $2.50 for the whole thing. but do make sure you get the 16 tooth and not the 20 tooth ones. As idler bearings for the belt, there are ready-made ones with a 3mm bore available. Whether you get the ones with or without the belt teeth doesn't really matter too much. Either type is about $1.50 per piece. I'd personally choose the ones with the belt teeth. And you're going to need one more bearing, yep, just a single 625 type, and you can't really just buy one of these, but at $1.50 for 10, it's not that big of a deal. If you're buying fastener from a proper hardware store, they might also have these regular radial ball bearings. To make the hardware complete, you'll need like a 100 pack of the standard 2.5 by 100 millimeter zip ties and two more essential parts. Z-axis couplers and motors. Now, I realize the Z-axis we're building here is going to be much closer to the Prusa i3 Mark 1, but that doesn't mean it's not going to work as well. The Mark 1 was already an excellent machine and printed absolutely beautifully, but of course, the Z-axis was a bit slower than the Mark 2s. It also used what looked like shrink wrap as Z-axis couplers, and I'm actually going to suggest something similar by using a bit of aquarium or water cooling hose with a 5mm inner diameter to couple the motor shaft to the M5 threaded rod, secured by a bunch of zip ties. This works extremely well, probably even better than real couplers, but of course you can also use those. They're not that expensive at around 80 cents per piece. The choice is up to you. I definitely like the PVC tubing solution a lot, but either one can work. And lastly, motors. For these, thanks to 3D printing being so popular these days, you can't really go wrong by buying whatever set of 5 NEMA 17 motors you can find on the cheap. These are mostly going to be very similar types, around 40mm long with a torque of about 40 Newton centimeters. Totally okay, no high-end requirements here, and whether you get them from an importer or directly from China, a set is going to cost about $42. Yes, that is the single most expensive component group yet, but then again, these are heavy, and heavy things are expensive to ship around. These are also parts that you can use for any 3D printer or other machine, but really, I don't see why you'd ever want to take this thing apart again. Well, yeah, okay, so next up, I guess it's time to build this thing. As always, that is going to happen in a live stream, but I'll also compress the build notes into a regular video of the series so that you won't have to sit through a 15-hour video just to get the rough idea. The build is going to go by the original manual from Prusa, but again, the next video will highlight the differences where things aren't quite as plug and play or just differ in what parts to use. For now, the updated bill of materials, the modified 3D printed parts, and the template for the frame are available on toms3d.org/dolly. And once everything is built and tested and works, I think I'll also upload the entire project to YouMagin. And that's it for today. If this video helped you out and maybe you're even already working on building your own, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment on how I can improve. Constructive criticism is always appreciated. Also, do consider subscribing to the channel and click that bell or YouTube might not notify you when the build stream goes live and the next video gets released. If you're going to be shopping on Amazon or AliExpress in this case, check out the affiliate links from the video description or head over to Patreon, that side, to support the channel directly and get access to monthly Q&A hangouts and more. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching and I will see you in the next one.